It's really taking responsibility of the quality of Manuka honey. And we're using sophisticated chemical profiling technique. So today I'll talk about the reasons we've done this research, what we've actually achieved, and where we're going from here. So Manuka honey is from a plant called Leptosperin scoparium, and that's the Manuka. There are other Leptosperins about, but it's deemed that Manuka is the scoparium. The current methods that are used internationally to qualify and quantify honey, the taste and aroma. Now, this is quite a subjective measure, and you can have trained sensory panelists, but they're very expensive to train and to run and maintain. Another one is pollen, and there's a growing evidence and belief in the science industry that just because you've got a percent pollen from a plant, it does not necessarily mean that there's the same percent of nectar coming from that same plant. That some of the bees have preferences, and at certain times of the year, to go and source out protein by way of pollen and bring it back to the hive. So it's not proportional. And the test can't differentiate between Manuka and Kanuka. And you can see that little black picture there. There's a Manuka pollen and a Kanuka pollen. So the naked eye, it's a basic test looking down a microscope and counting the different shapes and numbers. So it's not discriminatory enough. Colour and conductivity. Colour is just as it is, what hue and deepness of brown that the honey is. And then conductivity is an indirect measure of the ash content or mineral content of the honey. And it's been used internationally for various honeys, but we find it's not discriminating enough. And multifloral honey blends can be classified as Manuka due to that. So the research was undertaken by UMFHA, or was funded by UMFHA, and Analytica was contracted to do that work. And it was to look at for specific chemical markers that are signature compounds for the particular floral types. The whole purpose, or the whole thesis of this work, it was important. And up until now, there was always a doubt. If someone gave me a honey and said it's 100% Manuka honey, I'd have to doubt whether it was, because I'm only going on someone's belief. And if I characterised using my tests that honey, how could I be completely sure? So there was doubt. Jonathan Stevens came up with the concept that if we checked these chemical markers in nectar, we would be certain, and it would be beyond reasonable doubt, that those chemicals came for that particular floral type, for example, Manuka or Kanuka or Rewa Rewa. So if we found those chemicals in the nectar and we found them in the honey and vice versa, for the other floral types, we could be pretty certain that they were coming from that plant only. No chance for contamination. We identified some key markers that were statistically significantly attributed to Manuka honey as opposed to other honeys. And that became the basis of a classification system. This chemical called leptosperin, which is one of the key markers we use. And so, as you can see, that a value seems to be a cutoff of around about 100 milligrams per kilogram, that in the centre there, nearly all of them classify as Manuka, whereas the ones on the left, below the line, and they would be not Manuka, and then there's ones that are somewhere in between have been classified as a blend, a Manuka blend. So how can we send a tool out into industry to help monitor the quality of the honey being collected, being processed and being sold? And so we've really leveraged off some research that Dr. Jonathan Stevens did, looking at the fluorescence. This is the instrument here. As I said, it's based on fluorescence. The technology has been patented. We could use it in the field. We could use it in a processing plant and also in market, just to check that there's no adulteration or skullduggery going on.